Good morning. Welcome to First United Church of Christ, Schuylkill Haven, Pennsylvania. Thank you for joining us for worship. We come this day to give thanks and praise to God who gives us meaning, who gives us life, who gives us all that we have. We're grateful that you've joined with us. We hope you will join us again. And please invite others to come in this time of worship to give thanks and praise. We are on Facebook, as you probably know. You can also find us on YouTube. Again, if you would like our Facebook page and welcome others to join us, we always are happy to have people gather with us for worship. And we want to hear from you as well. If you have needs, if you have suggestions for how we might improve worship or what changes we might make, as this is new to us, doing worship via social media, we're very happy to hear your suggestions as we continue to work each week to improve what we do. The church is not yet open. We are still being cautious. We are erring on the side of love. We don't want anyone to be made ill as they come here. So we're waiting a little longer. We are in the church office. Jen Simanko, the church secretary, and I, Sean Van Dyke, pastor, are in the office Monday through Thursday, 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Don't hesitate to call us. We'll do our best to answer your questions, to meet your needs, and don't hesitate to call me at any time. You can not only reach me at church, but on my cell phone and at my home. We will want to know your prayer requests as well, as we're in this strange time when we're disconnected from one another. So please don't hesitate to send us a message on Facebook, to send me an email, call us, and let us know of prayer needs. We thank you for your continued gifts to the church, for your support that allows our ministry to continue. Of course, you may donate to us by mailing directly to the church, or if you are participating in online banking, then set up with your bank for them to send a check to the church. We truly appreciate your support as our ministry continues, as we coordinate with the Schuylkill Haven and Vicinity Council of Churches to maintain the food bank and to meet needs of people in the community as those arise. We as a church seek to live by our mission, which is to serve God through Christ and to serve others with love. Please join with us in that mission as we listen to God's call. Today is the first Sunday of the month when we celebrate communion at First Church. We invite you to join us, but you, of course, will need to provide your own bread and cup. So you might want to take a moment to do that. You may not have grape juice. You may not have wine. You may not have a slice of bread. But really, Jesus says, whenever we eat and drink and remember him, then we're joining communion. So find whatever will work for you for bread and cup as we share communion later in the service. During the summer, as we've been coming through the COVID-19 pandemic, all of us hoping it would have eased, it has not. I started studying the 12 steps of recovery programs and felt that they would really connect with us as we are in an unknown zone, so to speak, and seeking to recover hope. So the 12 steps in brief are, I can't, but God can, so I will let God. That means I need to look within and be honest with myself and others, admit my wrongs, and be ready to change. God will help me do this if I'm willing, and as I make amends to others, which means I need to be in a daily process of looking at my behavior, and praying and meditating that as I receive hope from God, I will give it away. So we've already explored the first four steps. Step one, we admitted we were powerless over our addictions and compulsive behaviors, that our lives had become unmanageable. We came to believe, step two, that a greater power than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Step three, we made a decision to turn our lives and our wills over to the care of God, to realize God can do a better job than we can without them. And step four, today's journey, we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. So as we prepare to do that, let us join in the call to worship from Psalm 145. God is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. God is good to all, having compassion on all creation. All will praise you. They will tell of your glory so that all people may know of your power for good. God is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. God upholds all who are falling and gives a new beginning to those who are discouraged. Let us believe this God who comes to us in compassion as we sing, God of the Ages, Who with Sure Command, led by our Minister of Music, Chris Evans.
Can be dangerous if we use it in the wrong ways. In fact, he said
anger can almost be like murder, like we're really, really hurting somebody. But I bet you've been angry before, right? I mean, what kind of things make you angry? How about when someone lies about you? Does that make you angry? Or what about if someone takes something that is yours? Doesn't that make you angry? Or what if you're punished for something you didn't even do, somebody else did it? Oh, that would make me so angry. So things happen to us all the time in our lives to make us angry. And pressure builds up, the tension builds up, and there's only one thing to do, right? We have to pop the top. Oh, no? You don't think that's a good idea if we pop the top? So you don't want to get sprayed all over, is that what you're telling me? I get it, and I think you're on to something. Because sometimes when we're angry and we let that anger off and it explodes, we spray everybody within our reach with not just sticky soda, but meanness. We spray them with bad words and with names we shouldn't say, and we just get so upset because we're hurting inside and it makes us angry, and then we want to hurt everybody around us who made us angry. But Jesus says that's not good. That's not a good way to handle anger. Anger tells us there's a problem, so we need to listen to anger. But then we need to talk about it. We need to say to everybody, you know, I'm angry. And this is why I'm angry. My feelings are hurt. I wasn't treated fairly. Or I did do something bad, and I want to say I'm sorry. So rather than exploding on everybody with our anger, we can talk about it and learn from what happened in the past so we won't make the same mistakes in the future. So thanks for stopping me. You're right. I shouldn't spray my anger or my soda on anybody else. Take care. See you next week. Would you join me in prayer? Merciful God, wash us clean of all our presumptions. Lift us from the burden of our preconceived notions, which hinder us from being open to you, to seeing you at work in our lives, still shaping your story. Receive us as your weary children and bless us with your word, that we may receive it and allow it to shape us into the people you have created us to be. Oh God, we come to you from many places with hearts overflowing with joy and gratitude, and yet also with weariness. We come barely hanging on to hope and faith, where there is much happening in our lives to challenge us. Nothing seems ordinary anymore, so always we are forced to reckon with something new and unexpected in our lives. We thank you for this community where we can come and hear your word of hope and remember that you have created us to be very good so that we may live despite the challenges of life, knowing that you guide us. We thank you for all new beginnings, even those which are difficult to receive. We thank you for showing us new ways of living your word. We pray for your children, for the infants harbored in their mother's wombs, for the children who are exploring the world and testing their imaginations, for young people challenged to become leaders of our new realities. We pray, Holy God, for your children of all ages, for those who are barely hanging on to life, and yet know to the core of their being that they are your beloved children, and you will claim them and welcome them to a new home. Holy God, we ask for your blessings on ourselves, on our work, on our efforts to feed your people in need, as well as feed our own souls. We pray for this nation, which just celebrated its birth, that we will be attentive to your will and to your guidance, that we will remember that as people of faith, our responsibility to you shapes our responsibility to our nation, that in all times and in all ways we may reflect your good will and your goodness to all. May we be light in your law, which saves us from destruction. May we listen to our Savior, Jesus Christ, who teaches us that our actions and habits may lead to harm unless we are attentive. Help us always to reject hate, that we may follow you, the God of love, that we may love you above all else, so that we may love one another as we love ourselves. Bind us together, holy God, as your people, made into the body of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. This summer, we're also following some of the stories of Acts as the early disciples build a new place of worship as they build Christianity out of Judaism. For we, in many ways, are being called to build anew. From Acts 4, while Peter and John were speaking to the people, the priests, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees came to them, much annoyed, because they were teaching the people and proclaiming that in Jesus there is resurrection of the dead. Now the Sadducees did not believe in resurrection, the Pharisees did. So they arrested Peter and John and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who heard the word of Christ believed, and they numbered about 5,000. The next day, the rulers, elders, and scribes of the temple assembled in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they made the prisoners, Peter and John, stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Meaning heal a man who could not walk. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick and are asked how this man has been made healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved." Now, when the leaders saw the boldness of Peter and John and realized they were uneducated and ordinary men, they were amazed and recognized them as companions of Jesus. When they saw the men who had been cured standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. So they ordered them to leave the council while they discussed the matter with one another. They said, "What will we do with them? For it is obvious to all who live in Jerusalem that a notable sign has been done through them. We cannot deny it. But to keep it from spreading further among the people, let us warn them to speak no more to anyone in this name." So they called them and ordered them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. Peter and John answered them, "Whether it is right in God's sight to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. For we cannot keep from speaking about what we have seen and heard. God had told them to do this." And then the leaders, after threatening Peter and John again, let them go, finding no way to punish them because of the people, for all of them praised God for what had happened. And we're also seeking the guidance of the Apostle Paul, writing to the church at Rome, a church he's never visited, teaching them what he knows of Christianity and offering them hope. From Romans 7, "I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can do what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do." So Paul is not saying that the physical body is evil, but that our inclinations to sin, that's what he means by my flesh. That's what leads us to evil. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self. But I see in my members, in my actions, another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? And his answer, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Would you join with me in confession? Holy God, we confess to you and to each other that we are tired and weighed down by the mistakes we have made. We confess we have done what we hate, hurting others in the process, even those closest to us. We forget Jesus' counsel to seek reconciliation. Instead, we allow anger and pride to separate us. Too often, we have delighted in evil. Lift the burden of anger and insult from us, for they are too heavy for us to carry. Save us from ourselves. Amen. And now let's take just a moment in silence for personal confession. Our assurance of forgiveness is this: wretched though we may be, we are rescued from death by our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Alleluia and amen. And now we join in singing the song of the week. For the summer, we're exploring James Taylor's songs. James has struggled throughout his life with issues of addiction and found hope through the 12-step process, was able to leave the addiction behind, and now lives a life that is at peace. When he wrote the song Country Road, he wrote it about the wonders of North Carolina, where he grew up. But to me, it speaks of the beauty of this entire nation. As we've just celebrated the 244th birth of the nation yesterday on July 4th, we sing Country Road today in celebration of America.
Mama don't understand it. She wants to know where I am.
this summer, we're following the 12 steps of recovery programs, recovery from addiction, from destructive behavior. It seemed to me this might be appropriate as we've been cloistered together under quarantine, stressed out, and sometimes it's been difficult to understand our emotions. I think that recovering hope may help us in this process. So step one again was, I can, but God can. So I'm going to let God help me as I look within. This year, 2020, has just been one hit after another. We keep thinking it's going to get easier, but it sure doesn't seem that way. Oh, we continue to see a spread of COVID-19 when we hoped it might be under control by now, and there's no promise it will be under control in the near future. So that certainly has changed our lives, reshaping them, and filling us with all kinds of questions. When the virus first emerged in the United States, we were told we didn't need masks. Now they say we do need to wear masks, that masks greatly reduce the spread of the virus. Their explanation was that when the virus first emerged, they were afraid that all of us would run out and snap up all of the medical masks that were available. And the government might have had a case to make there as we went out and snapped up all of the toilet paper and hoarded it. So their concern was masks would not be available for medical personnel who certainly need that protection more than the average citizen. So now we're asked to wear masks. Things change from month to month. And on top of emerging from the quarantine of the virus, we discovered a group of people who were very unhappy with what's happening in the United States, who are saying that we're not living up to our ideals, that we aren't truly offering equality for all. And so there have been protests, some of which have turned to riots. Thankfully, the protesters themselves seem to have controlled much of that activity. But all of this, as is understandable, has led us to heightened emotions and sometimes the response of anger. Everything is out of our control, and when things are out of control, we're filled with fear, and the natural response to fear to protect us is anger. But there is danger in anger, not in anger itself. That emotion tells us something. We need to listen to it and learn from it. But if we act on that anger, we can do so in a way that is destructive to others. So Jesus warns us, if we're not careful with our anger, in essence, we're committing murder. We're harming somebody else's soul, their spirit, as we spew out our anger. And so Jesus tells us that we need to be very careful with anger, for it has the ability to destroy. And in truth, if we hurt and harm someone else's spirit, we're also harming our own souls. We're putting ourselves at danger. But the story of the Bible is there is hope. We worship a God of hope who fills us with possibilities. The story of God, in essence, is a cycle that we repeat in our lives. God creates us, we reject God, and there's the fall, the broken relationship with God. But God is not willing to allow that brokenness to continue, so God redeems us. We're redeemed through the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, offered a new beginning, a new creation. This cycle repeating in our lives so that we may find hope. And as people of the Christian religion, I think it might be interesting for us to know where that word religion comes from. Cicero said that religion was derived from the word religere, meaning to read again, but later ancient scholars of Christianity and more modern writers connected with relegare, to bind fast. So whether we're reading again, looking at God's story again, or being bound together by God's story, as we participate in the Christian religion, we are reminded that we need God. We can't do things on our own, but God can help us and God will. We need to look within to do a moral inventory, to be honest about who we are. For just as Adam and Eve grasped to take what was unique to God and make it their own, we often do the same, playing God in our lives. We want to be independent. We want to do our own thing. We don't want anyone to interfere with us. But we are part of a community, not only a community of faith, but the community we live in. We're part of God's world, which means God has made us to be interdependent, connected with one another. And so when we reject that relationship, we participate in sin. We prefer ourselves over God, we love ourselves, and we fail to love others. Yet God offers us rebirth again and again, for God is gracious and good. And as we turn to God, God gives us a second chance to learn again, to see that we are part of God's story. And as we follow God, who forgives us, then we are called to forgive one another, to reconcile, to rejoin, to rebind with one another, to let go of the anger which can weigh us down and destroy us as well as others. One way to do this is to take a moral inventory, to look at our strengths and look at our weaknesses, to evaluate our past, to see how well we have upheld the followings of Jesus Christ and where we have fallen, to admit that we haven't always got it right, but we have got it right at some times. We need to look at our past to know who we are. Had James Taylor known at a much earlier age that he came from a long line of Taylor men who were alcoholics, who were addicts, it certainly would have helped him in some of the life choices that he was making. With his family history made known to him, he could have looked at the past and made better choices for his present, leading to a future that was full of goodness and joy. We need to let go of the past and not let it control us, but we also need to learn from it. Now, Paul expresses this competition with self, this cycle of fall and then restoration, through these words: I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And Paul tells us this is because of the sin within us, because we are competing to be God when there is only one God. It's not the law itself that is sinful. Paul wants to make that clear. God gave us the law to help us live together. It is we who have allowed sin to corrupt it by using the law to our own advantage so that we build ourselves up and push others down. It is we who participate in sin. And so Paul tells us what we need to do is to remember that we are part of God's people. As we engage in prayer, as we read God's word, as we live in the Spirit, then we will participate in God's story, reading the story again, allowing God to shape us and to make us more and more into the people God wants us to be. God will bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bud Welch was waiting at his home on the morning of April 19, 1995 for a call from his daughter, Julie, about their luncheon plans. And as he sat at his kitchen table, he heard a thunderous roar and the table and the floor shook under him. He was completely befuddled. What had happened? He couldn't understand. He got up and looked around, saw nothing. And then the phone rang. It was his brother telling him that there had been an explosion downtown. As he turned on his television, he saw the facade of the Alfred P. Murrow Federal Building had been blown away by a bomb, the building where his daughter Julie worked, and he realized why she had not called him. Yet he still held out hope for the next 2 days that as they searched, they would find her unconscious body somewhere under a pile of rubble, that she would be fine. But instead, they recovered Julie's body. And Bud found himself so in love with his daughter and so angry that her life had been ended at the age of 23, that he was consumed with hatred. He wanted nothing more than for Timothy McVeigh to be executed for his crime. And as his hate and anger consumed him, he began to question his own faith. Then one day, on the TV, he saw the father of Timothy McVeigh. And as his father looked directly into the camera, Bud saw the same hurt and pain of a parent that had lost a child that he himself knew. And Bud realized it was time to let go of the hate. It was only destroying him. He stopped advocating for Timothy McVeigh's execution and instead began to work with others toward a process of healing, not only the community of Oklahoma City, but others, healing for others who had experienced violence. Eventually, Bud and Bill met at Bud's initiative. Of course, the conversation initially between them was very awkward, and yet soon they were just Bud and Bill, discussing gardening and farming and gathering at the kitchen table for a cup of coffee when Bill's daughter, Jennifer, walked in. At the age of 24, she reminded Bill so much of his own daughter, Julie. When he prepared to leave, he and Jennifer engaged in a long embrace, both of them in tears. And Bud said to Bill and Jennifer, "We're all in this together. We are bound together. And we cannot change the past, but we can look ahead to the future. We can make a difference there. Instead of spreading hate and allowing the cycle of hate to continue, we can spread hope. We can change the world." As we just celebrated the 4th of July, celebrated our independence, it's also time to remember that we are interdependent. And in our interdependence as a nation, we have often struggled with one another in opposition. Civil unrest is nothing new to the United States of America. It began long before the Boston Tea Party in 1773. The first note of civil unrest in the colonies was in the year 1622. And those moments of civil unrest have unfolded for many reasons. In protest of taxes, in protest of abolition of alcohol, in protest of abolition of slavery. We've been a nation that has often taken to the streets to raise our voice in protest. And too often we have resorted to violence. But more often we have decided to listen to one another, to embrace the fact that as a nation we grow together when we listen to one another, when we reach out to one another, remembering that healing is possible through God in the name of Jesus Christ. But to do this, to be honest with one another, to listen to one another, whatever our circumstances, as a nation, as a family, as friends, we have to be honest with ourselves and one another. We need to make a searching and fearless moral inventory of our own selves, of our behavior, of our responses to one another, of our emotions, of our words, of our hate, of our anger, and to reject the behavior that tears us apart. Instead, seek reconciliation as Jesus teaches us. We cannot undo the past, but as we see it and understand it, we can learn from it as we move together into the future. Throughout the Bible, God tells us to remember. We are not supposed to reject our past. We are to let it inform us, to help us to grow as people of God. So God reminds us that once we were slaves in a strange land, but God rescued us and took us out of bondage to slavery. Jesus tells us to remember that if we love him, we will keep his commandments to love God and one another. Jesus told us to remember, "I am with you always to the end of the age," that nothing can break the bonds that tie us to Jesus Christ. We were created by God to be interdependent, to be people who know that as well as needing God, we need one another. And so as we remember who God is, what God has done for us, and what God has promised to do, then we can find hope. For we are part of God's story. God has created us to be very good. And although there are times when we fall, when sin takes control of us, we must reject that control. We must instead place ourselves in God's care, remembering it is God who can do what we cannot do for ourselves. God who redeems us through Jesus Christ and restores us to new life, that we may always know when we need hope and we need love, God will provide it. May we, like Peter and John, always tell of the wonderful things that we have seen and heard, done in the name of Jesus Christ. May nothing stop us from sharing that truth, from sharing that hope, from sharing that love. And now, would you join with me to affirm our faith using the words of the Serenity Prayer, written by Reinhold Niebuhr some years ago. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking as Jesus did this sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen. And now let us prepare ourselves for communion. Let us open our hearts and our minds and our spirits to God, that we may receive the Holy Spirit at this time. God is here. God's Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to God. Let us give thanks to God. It is good to give God thanks and praise. Chris Evans will sing for us the words of remembrance to prepare us for this moment, to prepare us to remember all that God has done for us as we gather at the communion table. Thank you.
respond to your invitation. We remember you.
Would you join with me in the prayer of consecration, followed by the Lord's Prayer? We give thanks to you, creating God, breath of all being. We know the earth is yours and all that is in it, and all who dwell on it. You created the seas, you made the earth, you planted seeds in fertile ground, and now all of creation rises to sing your praise. You planted goodness in our souls that we might love you. You gave us laws and commands that we might live in harmony with one another. Yet when our disordered cravings, when our behaviors of disobedience turned us away from you, you did not leave us alone. You met us where we were and helped us to grow again. Therefore, we lift our voices to you in thanksgiving, for you have wondrously made us. By water and your living spirit, you have more wondrously remade us to join in the song of all creation and to sing your praise with all of our hearts for all of our lives. Pour your Holy Spirit upon these gifts of blessing, O God, as we remember that on the night before Jesus died for us, he took bread and gave thanks to you. He broke the bread and gave it to his friends, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." As you bless this cup and bread, holy God, bind us together into the body of Christ, that in all that we do, we may remember we are part of your story, and you have invited us to follow Jesus Christ to life everlasting. This we pray as our Savior taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us, God, into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Jesus gathered with his disciples for the Passover meal, celebrating that thousands-year-old tradition, remembering when God had saved the people of Israel from slavery in Egypt. But now, the supper took on new meaning, for as Jesus broke the Passover bread, he said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken to save you from sin." And as he poured out the cup, he said, "This is my blood shed to wash away your sins." Come now to this sacred moment. Allow the Holy Spirit to enter your lives to make you new again through Jesus Christ. Remember that you are part of God's story and that God has created you to be very good. This is the bread of life, broken that we might be made whole. Take and eat. This is the cup of salvation which washes away our sins. Take and drink. you join with me again in prayer? We give you thanks, holy and gracious God, that you have planted your word in Jesus to grow your kingdom here on earth and to draw us near. Jesus planted forgiveness wherever he went to reap a greater righteousness. He shared bread with outcasts and sinners and healed the brokenhearted. And so although we feel unworthy to receive his gift, we offer our thanks to you, O God, that Jesus Christ has made us worthy and acceptable in your sight, that he has healed our brokenness and bound us together, that we may be his body, his hands, his feet, his love here on earth. O God, to you be the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now Chris will lead us in singing God of Grace and God of Glory. Others with love. Amen. May it be so.